Morning.
Morning.
Welcome to South Haven First United Methodist Church. We're coming to you from 723 Star Landing Road East this morning. And it's good to see everyone in the house of the Lord on this absolutely gorgeous Sunday morning.
Amen.
And I want to thank you for that beautiful prelude. You know, it's one of my favorites. It's more wonderful. And it gets to me when she plays it. Few announcements this morning. Don't forget to either mail or drop your tithes and offerings into the church office. The address is up on the screen. Now keep in mind, it is a Nesbitt, Mississippi address. We are South Haven First United Methodist Church, and we're in South Haven, Mississippi, city limits. But the closest post office to us is Nesbitt. Therefore, that's our mailing address. Wednesday night Bible study continues this week at 6 o'clock here, live and in person, and will be done also on the Facebook page. And then Thursday morning, again at 10 o'clock for those who can't get out on Wednesday night. Now, Brother Sam's going to be talking to you about a Maundy Thursday service that we will have coming up in a couple of weeks, right before Christmas time. He'll mention that this morning. We're having a food drive coming up on Saturday, April the 3rd, Ruth Williams Hooker is with us this morning, and if you have any questions, you can see her, but that's coming along
April
well.
April the 2nd.
Getting ready to mention that, we don't have any birthdays coming up this week, but there is an anniversary if you've read your bulletin this morning. Coming up this Saturday, the 27th, Beth Ellen and I have been married 5 years.
Yeah.
That doesn't. We got married right here on Easter Sunday, right after church, on March the 27th, 5 years ago. And she tells me to come midnight Friday night, the warranty expires. I'm not exactly sure what that means. Any other announcements this morning from the congregation? All right, our first hymn this morning, we're going to open, it's Easter time, and we're going to open with Because He Lives. It'll be on the book screen behind me. It's in your book in number 364. And we're going to sing all three verses. Number 364, Because He Lives.
My Savior lives, because He lives.
thank you, Jim Bethel, for opening up our time together here. As always, it is an honor to thank all of you for joining us and being a part of our service. I want to thank all you folks who are home right now watching us on our church Facebook page. And I want to ask you, if you're home watching today, be sure to give us a shout out. Let us know how God is blessing you in some way or another. So please let us know if you're watching. Give us a shout out. Just say hello if you want to. That would be a blessing to us. I also want to thank, we've got several visitors here with us today. Thank you. Thank you, visitors, for coming and being a part of our service. You blessed us. And I want to encourage all of our regular folks to see one of the visitors. Now, you can't shake hands, you can't hug necks like we're always accustomed to in our church, but you can at least say hello, give them a fist bump or anything like that. But be sure, okay, and let our visitors know how thankful we are that they are here with us today. Also, just like Jim was saying, I wanted to bring up about our Holy Thursday, Maundy Thursday service. It will be on Thursday, April the 1st. And what we're going to be doing is a one-time live broadcast. It won't be reposted or anything like that. And what we're going to do is all of us together, this is also for you folks at home who will be joining us by our Facebook page. And I'm inviting you to go ahead and get started now, making plans to get some grape juice and some bread and have that ready so that you can join us. We're going to do communion as the church, both physically, spiritually. So I invite you to be a part of that. And I'll let me go ahead and also just remind you, let you know, Easter Sunday will be right after that. And we're going to do something we haven't done in a couple years. We're going to move our service to 10 o'clock. There will be no Sunday school that day. But what we're going to do, we're going to have it set up as we used to do when people could come in between 9:30 and 9:55. Come that morning, get on in here, find your seat. But before you do, there will be a table in front of the altar table here. And the communion cups will be on that as well. And you'll be invited to come up, take communion, and then go and find your seat and then stay until time of prayer until we open up our Easter Sunday service. And you'll be hearing more about that, but make sure, put that on your calendar. You folks at home, you'll be able to join us as well. We'll have Easter Sunday with communion from 9:30 to 9:55, followed with worship at 10 o'clock, Easter Sunday morning. And now let me get to the reason why I'm really up here. And that is to continue on now in our service with our affirmation of faith. We're going to be doing this with our historic Apostles' Creed. And as always, when we have visitors or somebody new watching us online here, that I always just like to remind you that there's a beautiful line, it really is, in the Apostles' Creed. It's toward the end there. It says, believe in the Holy Spirit and the Holy Catholic Church. And somebody that hears that for the first time, sometimes I might want to choke a little bit, but what it is, it's just simply, it's not an allegiance to the Catholic Church or the Roman Catholic Church. Catholic is Latin for universal. We believe that one day when Jesus does come back, there's going to be one church. Not going to be all these different divisions. There will be one church as it should be, with Jesus sitting on his throne, overseeing all the churches, be one universal church. That's what I look forward to one day. And I hope you look forward to it as well. And so that's what we mean when we come to that part. So I invite you, if you will now, to help me out, and let's affirm our faith together as the body of Christ with the historic Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. continue on now in our service with a very special part, a time when we can go into a silent time of prayer. And as we join together, be sure, please remember all the needs of our church and our church family, the number of folks that I shared with our people here that are with us in person today. If you at home would like a list, a prayer list, it's here in our bulletin. Call the church office, send us an email, fax, text, whatever you need to do. Let us know. And we'd love to send you a prayer list as well to your house. But there are a number of needs that are going on, not just in our church, but in our state and our nation. Let's continue to keep all the doctors and nurses, all the frontline workers. Let us continue to lift up all those men and women of our forces and our fire and police departments. It's out there doing for us every day, keeping us safe. And so let us continue to remember those that have been sick and those that have lost loved ones as well. There's a lot going on, but the greatest thing is that none of it can overcome our God. None of it catches Him off guard in any way. And so I invite you, if you will, to join me in a time just of silent laying into God's hands whatever it is He lays upon your heart at this time. And let us pray silently as Bethel now plays and takes us together to the throne of grace. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, thank You once again for being the God who is in control of it all. But most importantly, for being the God, the One who is still in the business of answering prayers. And we give all these needs now to You and ask You to continue to bless and move in our midst now as we come into this time of worshiping and praising and celebrating You. So bless us now as we join together in one voice, lifting up the prayer that Jesus Himself gave to His disciples. And they know, they saw how great this prayer is, and they have now given it to us. So bless us now and hear us as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be Thy name. Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen and amen.
Yeah. joys that come with doing things live. Sometimes it just happens that way, doesn't it?
It was good anyway.
It was good anyway. Amen to that. Yes, it was. Jerry, you got another thank you again, as always, for all the music y'all put together for us. I want to continue on this morning by looking at the letter of 1 Corinthians. And I want to share with you from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 12 through 26. And so I invite all of you who are here, and any of you at home that like to do so, if you're able, to now please stand for the reading of God's holy word. And here Paul, under the guidance of the Spirit, has written for us. But tell me this, since we preach that Christ rose from the dead, why are some of you saying there will be no resurrection of the dead? For if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised either. And if Christ has not been raised, then all of our preaching is useless, and your faith is useless. And we apostles would all be lying about God, for we have said that God raised Christ from the grave. But that can't be true if there is no resurrection of the dead. And if there is no resurrection of the dead, then Christ has not been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then your faith is useless, and you are still guilty of your sins. In that case, all who have died believing in Christ are lost. And if our hope in Christ is only for this life, we are more to be pitied than anyone in the world. But, in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. Amen. He is the first of a great harvest of all who have died. So you see, just as death came into the world through a man, now the resurrection from the dead has begun through another man. Just as everyone dies because we all belong to Adam, everyone who belongs to Christ will be given new life. But there is an order to this resurrection. Christ was raised as the first of the harvest, then all who belong to Christ will be raised when He comes back. After that, the end will come when He will turn the kingdom over to God, the Father, having destroyed every ruler and authority and power. For Christ must reign until He humbles all His enemies beneath His feet, and the last enemy to be destroyed is death. May God bless the reading and the hearing of His holy word. And all of God's people together said, amen. God bless you. Thank you. Please be seated. Once again, let us pray. Gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we come now into Your presence, heads bowed but hearts lifted up. And we ask You now to move in our midst. To move in our midst as we are gathered here in person in Your sanctuary, Your holy of holies. But also move in the midst of our brothers and sisters who are now joining us spiritually, who are at their home or other places. Touch them as You are touching us. Bless them as You are blessing us now. And as You anoint us with Your Spirit, as always I pray without hesitation for a double portion of Your Spirit now upon me. And I ask this so that I can declare now with truth and boldness Your message of life for us. But as always, dear God, my deep prayer, my deepest and most sincere prayer is for You through the power of Your Spirit to not let Your church now hear my voice. Instead, dear God, through the power of Your Spirit, open up the ears of our heart and let us now hear the voice of our Savior Jesus. But greater than that, through the power of Your Spirit now, open the eyes of our heart. Open the eyes of our spirit and let Your church now look beyond me and not see me, but instead look up higher. And now let us see our living Lord and Savior Jesus. And I ask all this now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. It was back in January of the year 2000 that the leaders of Charlotte, North Carolina, invited their favorite son, Dr. Billy Graham, to a luncheon in his honor. Now, at first, he was hesitant, because if you know his story, he was struggling with Parkinson's disease at the time. But the Charlotte leader said that they didn't expect some great major address or sermon from him. They just wanted him to come so that they could honor him. So he agreed. Well, following the meal, a number of wonderful things were spoken of about him. Dr. Graham then stood up and he walked up to the podium. Looking out at the crowd, he told them how on that day he was reminded about Albert Einstein, the great physicist. And then at that podium, then Dr. Graham told a well-known story. You've heard it before yourself. A well-known story about Albert Einstein. The time he was traveling from Princeton on a train. And as he's traveling, the conductor is coming down the aisle, punching everybody's ticket. When he gets to Dr. Einstein reaches in the vest pocket of his vest that he's wearing there, and he can't find the ticket. He looks in all the coat pockets, the pockets of his pants, there is no ticket. He looks in his briefcase, cannot find the ticket. He looks on the seat in front of him, behind him, around him, and he cannot find the ticket. Well, according to the story, the conductor looks at him and says, "Dr. Einstein, don't worry about it. I know who you are. In fact, we all here in this car, we all know who you are. I know who you are, and I am sure that you bought a ticket. So don't worry about showing it to me." And the story goes that Dr. Einstein kind of looked up and in a, agreement, thankfulness, nodded to this conductor. The conductor makes his way on down the aisle. And as he finishes up all the other tickets, he's about to make his way into the next car. When he turns back and he looks and he sees Albert Einstein on his knees. His hands and knees looking on the floor of that car for his ticket. Well, the conductor quickly comes back to him and says, "Dr. Einstein, don't worry about the ticket. I know who you are. I know you bought a ticket." And with that, Billy Graham says that Albert Einstein looked up at that young conductor and says, "Young man, I know who I am. I know too who I am. What I don't know is where I am going." Now, having told that story then, Billy Graham continued by saying to the crowd, "Now, I want you to see this suit that I'm wearing. It's a brand new suit." And he then began to describe how his wife, his children and grandchildren, they had been telling him that he had gotten a little slovenly, very untidy with his clothes there in his old age. So he shares with the group that day how he went and he bought that suit, not just for the luncheon, but he bought it for one other occasion. He had bought that suit to be buried in. This was the suit he would be buried in that day. And as he looked at that crowd, he told them this. He said, "Now when news reaches you about my death, when you hear that I have died, I do not want you to think or remember anything about this suit that I am wearing. When you hear of my death, I want you to simply remember and think about this, that I not only know who I am, I also know where I am." In that beautiful story. In the letter here to 1 Corinthians that I'm sharing with today, Paul is writing now. He's writing to a group of brand new Christians who are making up the church. The church that he established in the city of Corinth back on his second missionary journey. And for those of you who were with me a couple of years ago, when we studied this letter of 1 Corinthians, when we studied it during our midweek Bible studies, we learned and we talked about the fact that what Paul is doing here is this. In writing this letter, he is responding to a number of questions. A number of questions that he's received by letter from these young Christians there in Corinth. Now, he's gotten a number of questions. Some of the questions being asked by these young Christians are about the conduct. How to conduct themselves when they are around non-believers. Some of the things that they've heard about Jesus in which questions his divinity. They're asking questions about that. But in our scripture reading for today, Paul is specifically answering one of these questions that has now been put before him. The thing is, most likely this year, this is the biggest question of them all, because it's a question that focuses directly on the foundation of their faith in Jesus. And we find out, we learn what this question is when we look at the opening part there in verse 12. Because of what he's saying here, Paul is answering this question. Is there a resurrection of the dead? Is there a resurrection of the dead? And so in answering that, the first thing he does, he begins then in verses 12 through 19. And basically what Paul says in response is simply this, that if there is no resurrection, that means that the following things are true. First off, that the gospel has no power to save. That the gospel, it also means it has no power to bring forgiveness. Or worst of all, that the gospel has no power to now give the gift of eternal life. He continues on in verse 17. Paul continues by saying that if Christ is not risen from the dead, then our faith is useless. And as a result, we still then, we ourselves are still under the same condemnation of our sins. We're still guilty of our sins, just like the world is. And because of that, in verse 18, he then says, if this is the case, then death is the only thing that we have to look forward to. And then he concludes this there in verse 19. And he says this, that if all this is true, then we as Christians, we are a group of people who are the most miserable in the world. And we are now nothing more than a group of people who are to be nothing but pitied. Because if Christ is not raised from the dead, then we are simply in the same condition with our lives as everybody else in the world. And as a result, all we've ever received is what can be called basically a pie in the sky promise with no value to the Christian life. But now, if you're like me, as you're reading this, you get into verse 20. And suddenly, in my spirit, and as I read this, I can suddenly feel Paul just stop. He kind of stops and he takes a breath. And then in verse 20, he begins to let them know, but everything I just said is not true. None of this has happened. We are not a people who should be pitied. We are not in no longer in the same condition within our lives as everybody else. And we do not have some pie in the sky promise given to us now for our lives. What he says there in verse 20, he said this, none of that is true because of one reason. And he says there, but in fact, Christ has been raised from the dead. Amen?
Amen.
Christ has been raised from the dead. And it is with this then that Paul begins to help these young Christians. Help them begin to understand that when you and I make the choice to come face to face then with the resurrection of Jesus Christ, that when you make that choice to come face to face with the resurrection, that that's when you can discover. You can discover how that resurrection, how His resurrection can now be not just proven in your life, but more importantly, how it can work in your life. How it can be seen in your life. And there are three ways that it can now be proven within you and me. The first one is found in verse 21, where it's simply this. The resurrection proves that good is stronger than evil. That good is stronger than evil. See, here in this part, Paul wants us to understand that you and I are now part of something great. We're part of the great harvest of life. We're part of the great harvest of life that was started by Christ Himself. You see, it was the forces of evil that crucified Jesus. The forces of evil that chose to fall on the side of the devil and not on the side of God. But Paul tells us with this verse that there is a great harvest. A great harvest that comes to us not just through the greatness of our God, but also, more importantly, through the goodness. Through the goodness of our God. And because of this, we have been given new life. The harvest of new life brought to us in the life of one man. And it's through this new life that you and I also will be a part of a great homecoming. Those of us who are also a part of this world, that when that day Jesus comes back, we will be part of the greatest harvest of all. We will be part of that harvest in which we will all be raised. All those who live within the resurrection will be lifted up to great heavenly life. And it all comes about because the goodness of our God is stronger than the evil of this world. The goodness of our God is found in the resurrection. The second one is found in verse 21, especially there in verse 22. You see, the resurrection proves that life is stronger than death. Life is stronger than death. Now here Paul is answering in verse 22 actually a second question. Why did Christ have to rise from the dead? And in response, what Paul is doing here is telling that the resurrection of Christ has broken the power of death that has prevailed on all humans, given to us since the time of Adam. But what is he really saying here? When I think about all this, I'm reminded of a story I told you years ago, and I'm going to tell you again. It was about a time when I was a youth pastor. And I had this seventh grade young boy, who came to me following our UMYF Sunday night again. I had been talking about this time of the year, about the crucifixion and Jesus being raised from the dead. And after UMYF was over, before he left, he came up to me and he asked me this question, why did Christ have to rise from the dead? But he asked it in a different way. His question was this: what did Jesus coming out of the tomb really do for us? Now, if you're like, you know me. If you're like me, but more importantly, you know me. And you know, I don't like to give just a spontaneous answer. I'm the type, I got to think it over, I got to mull it over in my mind. You give me a good question, I think it deserves a good answer. And so I told this young man, give me some time to pray about it and to think about it. And that's what I did. I continued to pray and to read and think about this. And then Sunday, about Tuesday night, God gave me a wonderful answer for this young man. So on Wednesday night, following the Bible study at our house, all the other youth were going to get some snacks. And I took this young man to the side and I asked him, do you remember the question that you asked me Sunday night? What did Jesus coming out of the tomb really do for us? And he said, yeah, I remember. But then I looked at him and says, now, I know this about you. I know that you like to play football with your friends in the park, right? He says, yeah, I love to do that. I said, well, now think about it for a moment. You and your friends, you go to the park and you divide up into two teams. One team goes to one end of the field, and you and your team go to the other. Now, that first team, they kick the ball to you and to your team. Now, the moment you get that ball, what are you trying to do? And he said, well, my team and I were trying to work together to get the ball down the field and cross the goal line. We have a goal line there, and so that we can then get 7 points for crossing the goal line. I said, that's right, but tell me something. What happens if you and your team only get that ball right about an inch from the goal line? A half an inch from the goal line, but you don't cross. Don't you get something for that? Don't you get some points for almost getting there? And he looked at me and he said, no, you don't get any points. I said, you don't get any points at all by getting close to the goal line? He said, no, you get no points at all. I looked at him and said, and that's what Jesus did for us when he came out of the tomb. Now, he had the same look at all of you got on your face right now. You know, what are you talking about? What I told him is that, yes, Jesus came and he died on that cross to bring forgiveness for all of our sins. But the truth is this, death was still the one in control. Death still was sin's victory. Death was still the one winning the game. We had forgiveness, but death was still the one in charge. And the thing is this, when Jesus came forth from that tomb, what he did, he picks us up and he carries us across the goal line and to where death no longer can win. Death no longer has control. Because of what he did on the cross, we have complete forgiveness of our sins, but because he carried across the goal line, we now have victory. We have the victory. Death does not. The thing is, what does this really mean? You see, the truth is, God wanted to do more for you and me than just give us forgiveness for our sins. You see, he also wanted to give us something even greater. He wanted to give us the gift of power over death. And how is God able to do that? Please listen to what God's about to say. God laid this on my heart, and I want to share it with you now. So, if you get anything, let this be the first thing out of the sermon that you take with you today. Write this down. How was God able to do this? It's simple, because of one very beautiful reason. You see, God's life is stronger than the devil's death. Amen? Oh, come on. Amen? Say that with me. You know, listen, okay. God's life is stronger.
Than the devil's death.
Now say it with me together, all right? God's life is stronger than the devil's death. Do you believe that today? That's the power of the resurrection. That's what the resurrection proves in our life. Because you see, we've been carrying that over the gold. We now have a gift, a power over death itself. And then there's the third way, there in verses 24 to 26. The resurrection proves that one man's life can make a difference. All right, let's be truthful right now. Let's tell the truth. None of you are here. None of you are here today because of this church building. And those of you at home, you're not really here because of our church's Facebook page. Let's be honest. None of you are here because I'm preaching this sermon. Because there are a lot better preachers out there than I am. A lot better pastors than I am. I know that. I'm not the reason why you're here. You and I, we are all here today because of the difference Jesus Christ has made in our lives. But more importantly, the way that Jesus brought this difference, His difference into our lives. And the way that Jesus made a difference in your life, it's found not just in the way that we live out our lives. More importantly, it's found in the lives of the ones that Jesus placed in your own life. John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, he taught that there were four ways for us to not just seek God, but more importantly, how we can discover God. The four ways he taught were called Scripture, Tradition, Experience, and Reason. Scripture, Tradition, Experience, and Reason. Now, in the past 5+ years that we've been together, I've already shared my testimony with you. And all of you know that from my testimony, it was reason. It was reason, the power of reason, that helped me to come and ask Jesus into my heart and eventually called me into this life of ministry. And it all started because, you see, I had a group of friends that I was watching. And I kept noticing in my mind, there was something different about them. They were different from other people that I hung out at school. This was a group of church. And I noticed the difference in Wesley, and in Mike, and in Kevin, and so many others. And I'll never forget that Saturday night, sitting there at the church and in the youth room with those friends of mine. And suddenly I couldn't stop myself. I blurted out, there's something different about all of you. There's something different. What is it? What is it that makes you different from everybody else? And I still remember my good friend Janet Hines, big, beautiful smile on her face, looked at me and said, it's because we've got Jesus in our heart. And immediately I reasoned, I want Him in mine. Even though I've been raised in the church, I wanted Jesus in my heart. But the biggest thing is just the difference. That difference that was made in my life, it came about. Not because these friends of mine, they were not living out the life of a dead man. The difference that was made in my life came about because I did not see a dead man living in their lives. No, the difference came about because I witnessed the difference that a living Savior can make in the life of someone else. That is why it's so important that we also continue to show the difference. To show the difference in the way that we act now. The way we react to things now than we used to do before Jesus. You see, we need to be a proof, a living proof of the resurrection. Because that's when we live out the greatest proof of all concerning who Jesus is. This is the reason why, friends, This is the reason why it's so important that we live out our lives each day as a living proof concerning the resurrection. Because friends, now the truth is this. You can come to church on Sunday mornings. You can turn your computer or iPad off. And you can tune us in. And you can do that every Sunday morning and tell the world what a difference Jesus makes. But if you're out there living the other 6 days for the devil, if you're out there the other 6 days of the week living for the dead devil, then what you're saying to all the people that are watching you these other 6 days, those people that are listening to you, is that the resurrection of Christ really doesn't make a difference at all. It's along the same lines of what I said many years ago to a church one Easter Sunday morning that actually got some people very mad at me. It got some folks upset with me. And I said this, I admit it. Because I've got the power of God, the power of the Holy Spirit come upon me, and I had to see it. And what I said was this. I said that Easter Sunday morning, I said that Easter Sunday is the only Sunday out of the year that you come to church, then what you're saying to the world is that what God has to offer is only good one day out of the year. You want to know the reason why these folks, some people got upset with me? Because they knew what I was saying was true. Yeah. They knew what I was saying was true. And they didn't like it because they knew I was right. You see, we're to be a living proof every day of the resurrection of Jesus. How do we do that then? I'm going to close by sharing with you this story. So by the time back in World War II, there was a church in London, England. And they were all set to celebrate what they were calling a harvest Thanksgiving service. Now, in the week leading up to that service, members of the church, they came and they placed their gifts of thanksgiving on the altar of that church. Now, in the center of that altar, there was a sheaf, a bundle of corn that was there. Now, unfortunately, that service was never held because the Saturday night before the service, there came a savage air raid from the German Air Force. And the church was hit by one of the bombs. And there it was left to just lie in ruins. The months of fall and winter passed on, and then spring came. One day somebody was passing by the ruins of that church, and they noticed that there were some green shoots that were coming up. The summer came, and the shoots flourished. And by the time autumn had come, there was now a flourishing patch of corn growing in the midst of the rubble. You see, not even the bombs, not even the destruction could kill the life of the corn and the seeds. Why? Because life was stronger than death. Life is stronger than death. And that is what the resurrection of Jesus is all about for you and me. This is what the resurrection of Jesus has done for you and for me today in our lives. You see, in the midst of the destruction that comes upon our lives through sin and death, God is now brought into this world for you and me, life now and life everlasting. But to do this, friends, we've got to make a choice ourselves. This season of Lent, we talk about it being a season of choice. We first talked about Jesus using those words, I do choose. I do choose to bring healing into your life. We then talked about the choices that Jesus did not make. And last week we talked about the choices that Jesus did make. Friends, now it's up to us. Now this season of choice is about the choice that you and I are going to make. Will we live this season of Lent with the Savior that died but still lies in a grave and a tomb? Or will you and I make the choice today to go forth every day to be a living proof of the resurrection? Because that's what Lent, that's what Easter is really about. And so I'm going to invite you at this time to let this be your prayer. Invite you to choose Jesus. And invite you to give yourself to Him. And to make that choice to be that living proof of the resurrection. Or the other choice is to just simply bow your head, say thank you, Jesus, and then get up and leave this church, turn off your computer at home,
and just go through Lent like you've done every year, every Lent for all of your life. Jesus made a choice for you and for me. Will we make the choice today? The choice is now up to us. And so Bethel is going to play, and I'm going to invite you to just bow your heads where you are. We're going to open up this altar again one day very soon. But until then, I'm going to let that altar be your chair. Those of you who are at home, put down that cup of coffee. Sit up straight. Bow your head. Give your heart to God. And let us now pray together. Pray silently. As Bethel is going to play our closing hymn, Pass Me Not, O Gentle Savior. So if you need to talk in any way, I'm always here for you. A phone call, a visit, whatever it takes for you. Know that the invitation, that the door is always open with Jesus and with God. And so now, brothers and sisters Christ, go forth in the love and peace of our Lord and Savior. Go forth to live your life out making the choice for Jesus, knowing that Jesus chose you and me first. And let us live our lives out each day. And when people look at you, as you go through this week, go through this season of Lent, let them see one who lives out the proof of the resurrection, each and every day of your life. And all of God's people together said,